progressive platform has a negligible chance of getting elected because he can never raise enough funds. The financiers are scared of the president that his example might set. If he wins at all, he can do no more than howl invectives and perform symbolic gestures like Eta Rosales and her colleagues on the party list, representatives in Congress. But they were always outvoted and they were, their voices were always drowned. If by long shot a progressive political party is able to elect a president and gain a majority in Congress, the system of separation of powers will check and balance it from carrying out its program. The point I'm trying to make is that a regime change that sets in motion the process toward system change must pursue the extra-constitutional path. But people's power, the most benign extra-constitutional method of changing a regime, has also been corrupted. It is indeed ironic that the president who usurped power through this method is now gloating over what Bunye calls people's power party. To some extent, that is true. There is a people's power party because many EDSA veterans are now wary of another people's power demonstration that will just install another trouble. But their absence from the streets does not signify support for the regime. For once, I agree with the bishops in their call for communal action. Monsignor Iñiguez explained that this is not pegged to a particular form of action. The movement should indeed invent new ways of expressing protest. Because since the PNP Civil Disturbance Unit, Management Unit, have been trained and equipped by the Americans, they have mastered the art of repression. Unless the military goes over to the side of the people and restrains these police units, it is impossible to replicate EDSA. Now the police do not wait for a huge crowd to converge in one place. They disperse the urban poor before they can leave their communities that are not covered by media. The students, workers, and middle-class demonstrators who cannot be dispersed in their campuses and places of residence are blocked with container vans and rows of baton-wielding policemen as they march toward the central convergence point. People from nearby provinces can no longer join rallies in Metro Manila because the local governments threaten the bus operators and bus drivers. I was told that there is going to be a rally this afternoon. I was told that there are helicopters that were engaged in cloud seeding so as to disperse us with artificial rain. So, don't tell me na walang lumiliit daw yung mga partisan bansa ni Mosquitos because ayaw na nilang they already have a people power party. It's just that the freedoms that they enjoyed before have been taken away from them. Halimbawa, yung 2001. In fairness to ERAP, he never allowed the military and the police to disperse the demonstration. I know, gusto sana ni Lacson na sumugod doon sa EDSA shrine. Pero pinagbawalan si ERAP. Probably that was also his biggest miscalculation because naniwala siya kay Avila Reyes. But the point is that it is now they have developed ways and means to prevent people from converging in one place. That's why the mass movement has to learn different ways of expressing protest. That is probably what the bishops mean by communal action. Because I think that given the situation now, it is only the military that can neutralize the police. Because the penchant for violence of this government has made the military an important player in the political game. The military rebels are a relatively new phenomenon in Philippine politics. We need to study them closely. But this subject is elusive, and it defies our usual research methods. In the first place, it is very difficult to obtain information because the rebel soldiers are extremely secretive. And if you manage to get into their circles, you are morally bound not to reveal many of the things you learn. In the second place, their alignments are extremely volatile. And in the third place, the quantification is of limited value. Unlike studying political parties and mass movements, you cannot gauge the potency of a military rebel group by the counting of heads. To analyze balance of forces in the military, it is useless to make numerical comparisons. You have to identify the combat effective units because the bulk of the servicemen are actually performing quasi-civilian functions and they do not count as a coup. Only the combat effective units matter, but where they are located determines their potential role. You also have to consider how disciplined are their troops, their level of morale, and the kinds of weapons they wield. Coups are by nature unpredictable. A predictable coup is doomed unless the intelligence men are sleeping on their jobs and the lawyers or the loyalist commanders are so inept. Coups depend on the element of surprise, speed, and precision. If these elements are present, a coup is usually bloodless. Soldiers do not want to shoot each other, especially if PMA missiles are on the other side. Sometimes they engage in what is called acoustic warfare, that is firing in empty space, because their objective is not to kill, but to erode the morale of their adversaries. And when a unit is able to demonstrate superior strength, the others will just lay down their arms. The victors never humiliate the vanquished. The vanquished are never asked to surrender. Both sides reach an amicable settlement, which nonetheless tell the political balance. According to the doctrine of civilian supremacy, the military is an inane political force that obeys the duly constituted authorities. This is a myth. The AFP have always sided with the elite, perceiving themselves as the guardians of the status quo. But when the legitimacy of an existing regime is subjected to serious challenge, the myth of a non-political army crumbles. They either embrace the Praetorian ideology and establish a military junta as in Burma, or they integrate with the popular movement and aspire for revolutionary change as in Venezuela. If there are generals with Praetorian ambitions in the AFP today, they must be in the upper layers of the chain of command. The generals who rose to the top through patronage may have imbibed the trap of power. When a crippled regime becomes untenable, they will be tempted to grab power, especially if assured of American support. GMA is therefore well advised to guide her flanks. She should be wary of those generals whose loyalty she bought, because they cannot be trusted. But the major, but the junior officers in Magdalo are a different breed. Many belong to poor, lower-class families. Having entered the PMA through a rigorous competitive examination, they are generally intelligent, questioning, and well-read. At the PMA, they took up social science and humanities courses, although political science is usually taught to indoctrinate them in the ideology of anti-communism. In some cases, however, the indoctrination backfired. Secret study groups were formed to discuss proscribed books. The process of radicalization also continued when they were in the field fighting guerrillas whose popular support they envied and whose tenacity they gradually admired. Meanwhile, they witnessed the corruption of their superiors while their men were short of ammunition and deprived of the most basic amenities. The degree of radicalization is uneven. Some joined the Magdalo out of pakikisama with their PA classmates. Others simply wish to clean up their ranks and bring back honor to the military profession. But there is a politically sophisticated hardcore, exemplified by Danilo Lim and Antonio Trillanes, seething with contempt for the elite and the trappers. They understand the need for system change. How pervasive in their influence among the combat effective units in Metro Manila, I am in no position to assess. But this much I am certain. They oppose Praetorianism. They know the military cannot govern without civilian support. They envision a democracy based on the concept of people's power as the alternative to an oligarchy pretending to be a democracy. The civilian activists should also realize that they need a military component. The elite have the resources and stomach for violence. They will hire goons and ally with the conservative reactionary elements of the armed forces and the police. An army on the side of the mass movement is the only deterrent force that they can respect. In 1986, the outcome might have been different had the Ram boys insisted on staying in the corridors of power instead of going back to the barracks. They might have countered the return of the Trapos and the oligarchs. At that time, however, they had a very narrow concept of reform as reforms in the armed forces. The leaders of Magdalo are much more sophisticated. I am painfully aware that a new social system cannot rise immediately after the collapse of the present order. For this reason, it is imperative to go through a transition period under a revolutionary government. A revolutionary government is one that plays the game by changing its rules. But the term evokes the frightening images of Marcos, Pinochet, Suharto, and Pol Pot. We should just remind our people that Cory Aquino ruled with a revolutionary government in the first 18 months. How else could she have dismantled Marcos's brand of oligarchy without discarding the 1973 Constitution, dissolving the Batasang Pambansa, and empowering herself to issue executive orders with the force of law? This gave her the opportunity to reconstruct the social system, but she wasted that opportunity. Instead, she revived the colonial institutions, restored the monopolies that Marcos had divested, and ushered back the old-time politicos. And she was more subservient to the IMF and World Bank than her deposed dictators.